You can visit that fabulous garden and many more on the San Antonio Water Saver Landscape Tour on October 4th, and that's going to be happening from 9 until 3 o'clock. Admission is free. Find out more at watersaverlandscapetour.org. Right now we're going to be talking about what are the insects in our gardens see and what they're looking for, I think more appropriately, with Andrea DeLong-Amaya from the Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center. Welcome back, Andrea.
Thanks for having me back.
Always fun to see you. What insects see? I have a flippant answer to that, and that's dinner.
Dinner. Feed me. That motivates everybody, I guess.
Well, but in a sense, that's what they are looking for. And, of course, I think most of us are aware that insects have a very different way of seeing the world than humans do. Largely unaware of that plants are adapted for them, not for us. And we love the flowers, but really the flowers are designed for the insects, right?
Exactly. Yes, yeah. For those plants that are pollinated by insects, they definitely have evolved together to have a mutualistic relationship. So the flowers need the mobile services of the insect because generally flowers don't have feet and can't walk around to find a mate, so they can encourage their insects to do that, travel for them.
I'm relieved the plants don't walk around. That's all I'm saying. It would change garden totally.
It would change our gardening for sure.
It would be leaving in droves for my place. We know that the plants are there really and live in relationship with the insects, much more so in many cases than in mankind. But let's talk about what looks good to us may not necessarily look good to an insect. It may not be attractive to them, right?
Yeah, most insects, and of course it varies by species, but in general, insects are going to see more on the UV end of the spectrum. Mm-hmm. So UV, blue, green, yellow, but then it starts kind of dropping off when you get to the red range.
Okay.
We see red,
but
you find that there really aren't a lot of really true deep saturated reds that are pollinated by insects.
Right.
They're usually bird pollinated. Hummingbirds, maybe particularly.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So to a bee, for example, they might see black instead of red or a gray instead of red. It starts losing the color, but then they see the UV, which we don't see.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. So an example might be there's a flower called a globe flower that is a yellow to us and also is seen by the bees as a yellow flower.
Mm-hmm.
There's another plant, the yellow marsh marigold, which to us looks like a brilliant bright yellow plant, but to a bee, it sees more of the yellow plus a little bit of the UV and it turns into like what you might call a bee purple.
Okay.
So they see something very different. And probably most people have seen the UV pictures where you can put a filter on a flower and see the different forms and colors that show up on the flower. It's very cool.
And oftentimes there are hidden patterns that we don't see at all.
Right. Yeah, a big important one are the nectar guides or the pollen guides, which might be a disc around the corolla that guides the insects into where the nectar is, or maybe it's stripes that kind of like a landing strip kind of look that will direct them to where the nectar is.
Hey guys, over here.
Yeah, here's dinner.
Right, here's the dinner, right. So it is fascinating that a lot of these things we're missing out on altogether, but that's okay.
You know,
it's part of the mystery of gardening, I guess.
Like you said, the plants aren't there for us. They're really there more for the insects.
Right. Well, you talked about the colors, and I was thinking about, for example, my Turk's cap right now, every morning I walk out into the garden, mobbed by butterflies, by hummingbirds.
Oh, hummingbirds, yeah.
Yeah, and never see really insects on them. So it's interesting to see.
I've occasionally seen some of the butterflies.
Like
the larger ones will come sometimes too.
Yeah, but right now it's all hummingbirds all the time.
Yeah, and the hummingbirds are probably not going to let anybody else come around anyway.
Probably
they're very defensive of their territory.
Right. So are there preferred colors that if people are interested, if they really want to attract wildlife to the garden? Are there, let's talk about preferred colors for different critters.
Yeah, so red is definitely going to attract more of the hummingbird pollinators. If you have red fruit, that might attract other mammals and other kinds of birds in the fruit form.
Okay.
If we're speaking just about flowers, the insects are going to find more the yellow, white, blue, purple range.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Yellow, white, blue, and purple. All right. Okay.
And then, of course, there's fragrance, which is another layer on top of that. Mm-hmm. You know, the insects and other pollinators might be attracted to color, but the fragrance can really be helpful. Like, hummingbirds really don't smell, so the red is really important to them.
Mm-hmm.
But butterflies and bees are very, and flies, which is another pollinator.
Sure. Very attentive to fragrance.
To fragrance, yeah.
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, I knew, of course, everybody knows that flies, you have a picnic, the flies show up
right.
because of the fragrance, right?
Although your typical housefly is probably not the, one of the major pollinators.
Sure.
You see, like, the hoverflies is another group of flies that are bee mimics that you might see. They, you think they're bees, but they might actually be flies.
Right. Well, the colors and the patterns, those that we see and we don't see, but we all see the color, the patterns or the forms of the flowers.
Oh, right, the overall shapes.
The shape of the flower, and that matters too, doesn't it?
Yeah, like butterflies, for example, really prefer flowers that are clustered. So you might have a head of flowers with lots of little flowers, mm-hmm. and the butterfly is able to land and get their feet on the other flowers, and then it's like one-stop shopping. They can just go get nectar out of each of the little individual flowers.
We've all seen that.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? Yeah.
So lantanas are a really good mm-hmm. example, or plants in the lantana family, mm-hmm. like verbenas and that sort of thing, mm-hmm. are really good for attracting butterflies.
Right.
Bees often will like to have some kind of landing platform also, like maybe a lip on a salvia.
Mm-hmm.
Although you've maybe seen this too, it's funny sometimes to see these very heavy bumblebees land on a salvia flower, and they land and they're so heavy they just pull the flower all the way off the plant.
Right.
So that's kind of interesting to watch.
Yeah.
But, you know, they can land on something and then get the nectar deeper in the mm-hmm. in the flower too.
You know, often on the salvias you see them checking it where the petal actually attaches to the stem too. There must be some kind of pollen or nectar available at the very back.
I think what happens is sometimes the bees, depending on the shape of the flower and how big the tube is, a bumblebee may not be able to actually fit in there, so they kind of go from the side. In fact, there's a term called nectar robber, which means, which, you know, an insect might actually chew into the flower and get nectar from the side, which is kind of cheating because, you know, the flowers want the pollination services that
right.
the pollinators give. So if they're getting the nectar for free, that's not
free
helping
riding.
The flower.
Yeah. Free riding bee.
And you can see, sometimes I'll walk around the garden, I'll see little holes at the base of a mm-hmm. of a tube type flower, like okay. salvia sometimes,
yeah,
or desert willow, or
often, yeah.
yellow bells, the mm-hmm. Esperanza, we'll mm-hmm. see sometimes little holes.
Okay. Well, now I know they're freeloading out there.
Yeah.
It's interesting that because of man's intervention in the garden, and we've been messing with plants for a millennia now, and trying to adapt them to what we like aesthetically, but sometimes the end result is a plant that really doesn't have much value, right?
Yeah, you can have a flower that's very pretty and showy and a bright color, but if it doesn't have good nectar or good mm-hmm. pollen for the mm-hmm. insects to appreciate, they're not really doing anything from an ecological perspective for the wildlife anywhere, for the insects.
Right, and what might be a good pollinator in China or Japan may not necessarily work here, right?
Right, that's definitely true. And so that brings us in, you know, into you talking more about using native plants, using things that are local to your area,
right.
where you have more relationships specific to mm-hmm. the native pollinators and the native plants.
And there's a surge in interest right now just because of the plight of the monarchs, and people making sure that we're planting out things
right.
that really do attract all varieties of insects and birds into the garden.
Right, monarchs is a very popular insect, but really helping monarchs really helps all sorts of insects. And a lot of people are concerned about bees,
mm-hmm.
you know, the colony collapse disorders
right.
and decline of honeybees, but also our native populations right. of native bees too.
Well, people, I know that there's an opportunity coming up soon where people can pick up a lot of the native plants that will be perfect for all of our Texas pollinators.
Yes.
And that is like a setup for you for the native plant sale is coming up, right?
Yeah, that's right. So we'll have our fall plant sale, mm-hmm. which is the weekend of October 10th and 11th.
Okay.
And so that will be, as we've done before, we'll have about 300 species of native Texas plants, a good variety of very drought-resistant things, good pollinator plants for bees and butterflies, all sorts of things for wildlife in general, too.
Great. Well, mm-hmm. I know it's always a quick sellout, so people should arrive early, and there's always an early bird thing for members of the Wildflower Center.
That's right. Right? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, folks, you've been warned. go get your, whatever color they are, get them. Flowers at the Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center sale. Andrea, thank you so much for
thank
being
you.
Our guest.
Thank you. It was really fun.
Okay. Coming up next is our friend Daphne.